For the final presentation, we've invited Jim Weirich, the gentleman to my left here, to come out. He graciously accepted to come out. Jim works for Educase, is located in which city?
Educase is in Columbus. I'm in Cincinnati.
Okay. He's in Cincinnati, Educase is in Columbus. I've known Jim now for, we're almost on 3 years, I think. I showed up at RubyConf in 2006. Can't tell you what he presented on then. I can't reference each of the videos because we don't have any in 2006. But due to RubyConf 06, we created Confreaks, did all that. So Jim has been a major inspiration for test-driven development, getting me out of the write code, play with it, see if it works, and then push it out to a customer to actually doing rendering and refactoring. I would say on a regular basis, but I don't write code on a regular basis these days. Unless I'm planning on my own projects. But with that, the other thing that I've utilized Jim for is both him and his partner do test driven development training. We had them out in early February at AT&TI, or AT&T and I, whoever we are, AT&T and I. pulled 30 engineers off working full time so that we could spend 3 days learning from Jim and his partner. And the other thing I want to mention, if any of you are enterprise related, working in enterprise businesses, Jim and Joe host a conference in Ohio in the fall.
August.
In August, called eRubyCon, which is definitely worth getting involved with. With that, I'll turn the mic over to Jim, and a special round of applause for him flying all the way out here from Ohio.
I can't say anything until Kobe gets back to the camera, so.
Mic's not on.
Yeah, that's probably good. Your mic's not on.
Testing.
There we go. Woo! That's awesome. Very good. Now we're going to make this whole thing. You got the thumbs up. Okay. I'm Jim Weirich, as I was introduced, and I'm the chief scientist for Educase. Before that, I worked with CompuWare as a consultant. And one of the things I did for those two companies, and I still do for Educase, and I also do for clients that I work with, is do a lot of technical interviews. I will talk to someone on a phone for half an hour, 1 hour, and I will try to probe their technical skills in different areas. Generally, Java-based or Ruby-based type stuff. I look at object-oriented design, the knowledge in that. I look at how they know about agile development, and just general ideas I do this over phone. I ask design questions, I ask language-based questions, and get a feel for that, just the technical stuff. One of the favorite questions I like to ask is, what do you look for when you're doing a design? What makes a design good? If I were to lay two software designs, two architectures in front of you and say, would you do it this way or do it that way, which one would you choose? And more importantly, why would you choose one over the other? What makes a good software design? And the scary thing is, most people, their answer is, and they kind of freeze. They don't know what to answer. So let me ask this question to you. What makes a good software design? Give me some feedback.
Sustainability.
Something-ability?
Sustainability.
Sustainability. And by that you mean?
Maintainability.
Maintainability.
Communication doesn't fall off a cliff 6 months down the road.
Okay. Yes.
It should be as simple as possible and no simpler.
Simple as possible, but no simpler.
Modular.
Scalable. Scalable, like your modular over here.
Right. Don't repeat yourself.
Don't dry. Don't repeat yourself in the back.
Beautiful.
Beautiful. I like that, but then that begs the question, Buckwheat's beautiful code. Another interesting question. Okay, good, I'm glad you guys have answers. A lot of people I've talked to don't have those, or they can't express it in a way, in words, which means they might have a good feel for this design is better than the other, but they can't quite put it into words. So think about this for about the next 15 minutes or so, and we're going to talk about an entirely different topic. Why is her hair standing on? Straight out like that. Magic. It's magic, yes. She's touching the Van de Graaff generator, pumping all kinds of negatively charged particles into her body, and we know that charged particles attract and repulse each other according to certain rules. Essentially, if you have two particles of the same charge, they will try to get away from each other. If you have them very close together, the repulsion is quite strong. If they are farther away, the repulsion is much weaker. So it depends upon how far apart they are. This is an electric charge, and any electric charge creates an electric field around it. An electric field is nothing more than the force generated by that charge at every point in space. Strong close to the particle, weak farther away from the particle. Now we can represent this field at a particular point in space as an arrow in the direction the force is pointing. And it's very interesting. Now, most electric fields are static, but it's very easy to generate an electric field that varies, that moves back and forth. Now, the interesting thing about a changing electric field is that it never exists alone. Whenever you have a changing electric field, you also have a changing magnetic field that for some odd reason is perpendicular to the electric field at that point. So essentially, if you take a charged particle and shake it up and down really, really fast, you get a changing electric field and changing magnetic field. Now this is really interesting because back in the 1800s, scientists knew about electric forces and they knew about magnetic forces. And they discovered that there's this bizarre relationship between them, but they couldn't quite figure out what that was. I gave this talk last week in Edinburgh, Scotland, and it turns out that James Clerk Maxwell was born, educated in Edinburgh. I didn't know that when I gave this talk, so now you have more information. Maxwell came up with a set of equations, four partial differential equations called Maxwell's equations, surprisingly, that describe the relationship between a changing electric field and the changing magnetic field, and describes it in such a way that he can very clearly define how they change in relationship to each other. It turns out when they change, they generate a wave in space, an electromagnetic wave. Light. Light is an electromagnetic wave. So by describing these two entirely separate forces, and by unifying them together, he was able to come up with the entire theory of electromagnetism. And this work was done in the 1800s. Beautiful work. In fact, Wikipedia says that Maxwell's work in producing a unified model of electromagnetism is considered to be one of the greatest advances in physics. And someone back here mentioned beauty. When you can do this with two separate things and unify them, that is a thing of beauty. In the early 1900s, the beginning of the 20th century, physicists decided that they pretty well knew everything there was to know. In fact, prominent physicists were telling people entering the universities that they should not study physics because everything was figured out. There were a few minor details they needed to work out and figure out what was going on, but for the most part, they pretty well understood the nature of the universe, and there was nothing left to learn in physics. At the time, they believed that matter was like oatmeal. In other words, the positive and negative charges, and they knew that there were these charges in matter, but these charges were kind of spread out more or less evenly in this kind of rather lumpy, soft, oatmeal-like material. And there was no real structure in there at all, it was just kind of oatmeal-like. In the early 1900s, another fellow named Ernest Rutherford decided to do a really interesting experiment. He took a gold leaf foil and hammered it down till it was as thin as he could possibly make it. Just a few atoms thick. Absolutely, you could almost see through the gold foil, it was that thin. And then he took a beam of alpha particles. He wasn't quite sure what alpha particles were, but he knew they were positive charged. And he shot them through the gold foil. And he made a prediction. He says, if gold foil is really structured like oatmeal, most of my alpha particles are going to hit the backside of that detector. And they will scatter about, a little bit. But most of them will go mainly straight through with just very little deflection either way. The result he got was surprising. And it said that the best advances in physics happened with a failed experiment. And the results he got back were utterly surprising because they did deviate a little bit. But there was a small number of particles that deviated widely. They were reflected off to 90 degrees. A few, about 1 in 8,000 particles, were reflected almost straight back at the particle emitter. Rutherford said, if matter is really oatmeal, and it's all mush, what in the world is causing these things to bounce back? They should just shoot through that opening like bullets. So something was wrong with this theory of matter. And so instead of being like oatmeal, it was like oatmeal with raisins. Something was hard in that oatmeal, reflecting it back. And by further studying reflection, they began to get a better understanding of how matter was made. It turns out, and the Bohr model of the atom was created, we have a positive center of the atom. The atom is mostly empty space with a kind of wispy electric electron cloud orbiting the very small nucleus. Now this isn't a scale, a real scale thing. We have that nucleus impossible to see, so small. So matter is mostly open space. That's why the alpha particles went straight through. Those that reflected back are the ones that hit that tiny, tiny nucleus in the middle. And by examining that, they can figure out exactly how big that nucleus was by the nature of the reflection of the alpha particles. Fascinating stuff. So now we have a nucleus of a whole bunch of positively charged, well, we call them protons. We understand that they're protons. How, what did I say at the very beginning? Things that have the same charge do what? They repel each other. So how in the world do you get all these positively charged protons together in one tiny space? Why doesn't it fly apart? So all of a sudden, mystery started opening up in our understanding of the world. Turns out we didn't have anywhere near the understanding we thought we did at the beginning of the 19th century. Turns out there's a number of forces involved. We've unified magnetism and electric fields into a single field, electromagnetic fields. We know about gravity, that's been studied since Newton's day. We fairly well understood that. Turns out that there is another force called the strong nuclear force that binds the protons together, and even though they're electrically repulsed from each other, the strong nuclear force is stronger and binds them together. And not only do we have that, there's also a weak nuclear force that has something to do with what's called beta decay. And I'm not sure I can explain that, but the physicists understand that there are now four separate fields that they have to deal with. And this bothers physicists. Because physicists, like programmers, deal in three kinds of numbers, zero, one, and many. And you can get away with maybe two fields, electromagnetism and gravity, but why four? 4 doesn't make any sense to the physicists. Why not 5? Why not 3? Why not 20? You know, they have no theory that explains why there are only 4. So physicists are desperately trying to unify the 4 fields together under what's called the grand unified field theory. And they've been working on this for 100 years. Ever since they knew about the different fields, they wanted to bring them all together. Einstein tried to work on a unified field theory and failed. And there's no real good theory right now. There's a couple things like string theory, and it gets into like 14 dimensions or so. And it hurts my head to even think about it. So it's not simple anymore. So that's the state of physics today. We've got a bunch of things that are out there, and we're trying to bring them together under one grand unified theory. So let's talk about principles. So back to software now. We mentioned some principles that you use. Someone mentioned dry, don't repeat yourself principle. The solid principles. Anybody know what the solid principles are? Yeah, I saw one hand back there. Yeah, there are 5 principles. Paul Martin talks about them a lot. They're talking about the single responsibility, open-closed principle, L is list cost substitution principle, I is interface segregation, and the D is dependency inversion. Talks about how objects relate to each other and how to write good code. 5 principles there. There's small methods. It's designed by contractor. If you ever use Eiffel, how to write software so they can cooperate together. So there's lots of ideas on how to write good software. But we don't have a grand unified theory of software development yet. So I want to present some ideas today that might prompt you to think about how we might unify at least some of these things, get down from 20 principles down to a handful. Okay, so the topic by title is really the grand unified theory of software development. I didn't like the modularity title. I had to submit the abstract early and I couldn't think of a good name. This name came to me later, so I like this name much better because I want to think about how to unify all these ideas. Go back in time to when I was first starting writing software. My mentor gave me a book by Glenford Myers called Composite Structured Design. Now back in that day, everything was structured this and structured that. It was like object-oriented, or functional programming is today. It was the big fad. So you had to call everything structured something or other. I just got my timer. I have no idea how long I've been talking. The thing I remember most about this particular book was that he defined coupling and cohesion in a very straightforward way. And today I want to talk particularly about coupling. And Myers defined 7 layers of coupling, starting from the top, where it's the weakest and best kind of coupling, down to the bottom, which is the strongest and worst kind of coupling, and kind of put them in this ordering. And it's actually a very good ordering. I really like it. Let's talk about the ends of that. At the top, we have no coupling whatsoever. That's easy. If this software has no interface to this software over here, they are not coupled at all. And that's a good kind of coupling. Now, if we threw all our modules and made them uncoupled to each other, we wouldn't have any programs that actually work together. So we do need some kind of coupling between modules. The bottommost is content coupling, and that's evil. That is when you reach in the innards of a module and manipulate the insides that were never intended to be manipulated like that. Myers uses the example of writing assembly programs that jump into the middle of a method instead of starting at the beginning. You know, really strange stuff like that. Calculating offsets in the memory from things that you shouldn't be doing. You know, really evil kinds of coupling. That's content. It's so bad, most people don't even do that today, so I'm not really worried about that. These 4 in the middle are really interesting because they're related. They are related by the fact they pass data back and forth between modules. The top 2 pass data via local method. In other words, generally parameters. I call this method and I pass parameters into it. So that makes that the calling method coupled to the caller method through the fact I'm passing data to it. The bottom two pass data via globals, which we all know is bad. We tend to avoid globals these days. So that's why they are lower on the list with more coupling. The distinction between the top two and the bottom two together is the distinction between simple data and structured data. If I call a method and only pass in simple data types like integers, strings, symbols, you know, things that have no internal structure, that's a lightweight kind of coupling. If I call an object and I pass in a user object, that's a complex object. It has methods on it and all kinds of assumptions. And so when you pass complex data, that's a higher coupling than passing simple data. So that's the distinction between data coupling and standard coupling. The difference between external coupling and common coupling is the same, except you're passing structured global data versus passing simple global data. Okay. So those are easy enough to understand, and it's fairly easy to agree with the ordering there. The middle one. Content coupling is really interesting because it's different than the other. It also deals with passing of data, but rather than the type of data, it is the intention of the data that matters. In control coupling, there's two things that flag control coupling. The method, the parameter passing in is some kind of flag that instructs the method you're calling to do one thing or the other. Okay? And you can tell this generally by the fact that the description of the function generally contains the word or something semantically equivalent to or. And the other thing you can tell is that the flag value is arbitrary. It's not related to the domain or the problem that you're trying to solve. True, false is rather arbitrary. Let's look at this method. What does this method do? Okay, very well, hold on. Like it returns the instance methods on array. What do these methods do?
Returns the private ones.
Which one returns the private ones? I'm going to say true returns the private ones.
False.
I'm going to say false returns the private ones. How many have no idea whatsoever? That's control coupling. True false has no relationship to the meaning of the method. If you wrote two methods here, private instance methods and all instance methods, or whatever, you know, then you could, it'd be easy, it'd be obvious. There would be no control coupling there at all. Okay. Also, the example has this in the description. It uses the word otherwise, which I will claim is semantically equivalent to or. Okay, another example. Rails does this. Control coupling, right? The fact that we use the symbol first has no intrinsic meaning to the problem that we're describing. Furthermore, they return different kinds of things. One returns a single object, the other returns a list of objects. So if I actually pass that first parameter in as a variable, I wouldn't know how to handle the result returned to me because I wouldn't know if it's an array or a single object. You have to know what that first parameter is. So another example of control coupling. It's a little bit better because at least you use symbols that hint at the meaning, but it's still control coupling. Now, Miner's classifications were pretty good. For the time. This is back in the day when Fortran and Pascal, C was beginning to get some popularity. So these classifications work really well for the statically compiled straightforward languages like that. However, in today's dynamic languages that use object orientation, these categories are weak. They really don't cover all the way that we can pass things around and couple today, so especially in Ruby, which allows such dynamic behavior. So these categories, well, is a good start, is not quite where I want to be. So let's fast forward to 1996. And a fellow named Mueller Paige Jones, wrote a book called What Every Programmer Should Know About Object-Oriented Programming. Rather pretentious title. Nearly as bad as the Grand Unified Theory of Software Development. And in this book, now this is a good book. It has three sections in it. The first section is an introduction to object-oriented design. If you've used Ruby, you're way past that introduction, you won't need it. So forget the first section. The middle section is a description of a graphical notation to use to describe your designs. Who uses UML these days? You don't even use UML hardly at all. This wasn't even UML, this is before UML. No one uses this notation. So the middle section of the book, forget it. However, the third section of the book talked about a concept that I would like to share with you today. That concept is called kinesis. And kinesis means things that are born together and change together. In other words, he's trying to capture the idea of what pieces of code affect other pieces of code. In terms of software, two pieces of software share a kinesis when if I have to change this module, that module needs to be changed as well. Or at least I have to look at that module to see if it needs changing. So things share kinesis when changes in one affect changes in the other. That's the basic definition of kinesis. If you stop there, that'd be pretty good. But Mueller Page Jones took that a little bit farther and said there are categories of kinesis that we can talk about. And the first one we're going to talk about is this. Suppose I have a model called customer, and it has an email method in it. And then I use that email method in some other client code. I want to send some email, and I call the email method on a customer object. There is a kinesis between these two pieces of code identified by the name of the method. We call this kinesis of name because changing the name in one requires a change of name in the other piece of code. So they are coupled by a name. Are there other examples of kinesis of name in this code right here? Okay. I heard several different responses. Some people say, I'm sorry, I forgot this slide. Kinesis name not only applies to code, but can apply to things like the database. If I change the database, I might have to change the name there. Okay, so other examples here. Some people will say the name of the class and the name of the variable. That is actually not kinesis of name, because I can change the class name, and the variable name doesn't matter. It's nice, more readable that they are the same, but it doesn't affect the meaning of the program. So that's not kinesis of name. However, there is another example, and that's right here. The parameter in the method has to match the name that you use inside the method. This is obvious. We all know this. So there's nothing real deep here. But the point is that you can have kinesis between close pieces of code and kinesis between code that is more distant than another. That leads to a principle that I call locality. If you have things that are grouped together, the kinesis between the things that are grouped in the same class, for example, in the same method, in the same class, in the same module, can have stronger kinesis than things that are separated farther apart. So it's okay to have stronger kinesis than things that are close, the principle of locality. As the distance between software components increases, you want to decrease the coupling and kinesis between them. Okay, that's kinesis of name. Let's talk about another kind of kinesis. I was working on a Rails app that returned parameter values in a hash like this. The key of the hash was the order number, identifying the order in the database. The second parameter was whether the order should be expedited or not. It was a checkbox value that came back. And I turned this funky hash from param into something that I could handle a little better. I looked up the order, based upon the first number, and then I would put a expedite flag, true or false, in the second position. Control comma right here. Watch it real closely. But that's okay, but this is a different kind actually have an order couple that if I were to process the order and do it in each loop, I have to specify the parameters in the lambda for the each, and they have to be in the same order as they are in the list. In fact, if I build the place where I build the order list from and the place where I process the ordering list has a kinesis between it, we call that kinesis a position. If I change the position of those things in the ordered pair, I switch them around, then I have to change every piece of code that assumes the order's in the first position and the flag is in the second position. That's kinesis of position. Okay, think about this. This did not bother me too much. The ordered pair seemed kind of natural. The order would come first and the flag was second. However, suppose I had something that looked like this. If I had to write this code, all of a sudden I would begin to get bothered by the fact that I'm depending upon the exact position in this list of what the items were. This is a very strong kinesis of position, a higher degree of kinesis of position. If I ran into that code, I would probably convert it from an ordered list into a more structured type of thing, a struct in Ruby, or a class, or at least something, a hash, at least, where I had the names of the things, and I didn't any longer depend on what the particular order. This is a reduction from kinesis of position to kinesis of name, which I would claim kinesis of name is probably a better, a weaker form of kinesis. So when the degree of kinesis gets too large, you want to reduce the form of kinesis to a weaker form of kinesis. Okay, so degree matters. Okay, another example here. Suppose I had a find method that took two parameters, the condition and the field to sort the results by. Again, I wouldn't hesitate to do this. In fact, I understand that early versions of Rails did exactly this with their find method, something very similar to this. However, when you start to get a lot of things in that parameter list, that begins to get unwieldy. You're suffering from kinesis of position. Parameter lists are bound by the order. When you have a lot of things in that list, that should begin to bother you. Personally, one item, two items, maybe three items I wouldn't think much about. When I start getting three to four items, I start wondering, is there a better way to pass data around than just in an unordered list? This is another example of high degree of kinesis. I want to convert that to something else. In this case, in Rails, what they did, they converted it to kinesis of name by introducing a hash and keys. So the order no longer matters, and you tie everything back to a name. So now we've got kinesis of name coupling those two things. Okay, another example. Oh, this one, yes. We were running tests. And in our test, we needed an example user. So we just said, user, give me the first user in the test. And that worked great when I ran a workload. And it worked great when I uploaded it to our continuous integration server. But when my buddy downloaded the code, it merged his code with mine, this test failed. Actually, it worked for a long time. It wasn't until we introduced roles into the user objects, so certain users could do certain things. And all of a sudden, which particular user you got started to matter. And the ordering of users in my local database was different than the ordering of users in Chris's database. So we had a really strange kinesis of position issue with data in our database. The solution to that was to go to kinesis of name. Find the exact user you want and use that to depend upon the random ordering of data in the database. Okay, another kinesis. We're here in a medical program where we give out medications. They have a set of two checkboxes that are given, not given, or leave unchecked to indicate that we're kind of skipping this, that there's no decision at this point. And these values come back in a form like this, where 2 is not given and 1 is given. So the code that processes this has to actually check for those values. If you were reading this code, how would you know that's correct? You'd have to go and compare both of them. Oh, let's see, one means this, two means this. What we have is kinesis of meaning, where two pieces of code have to agree upon the meaning of a particular piece of data. Solution, again, reduced to kinesis of name, where we introduce constants that have the values, we write our code like this, and now we got kinesis of name between three pieces of software. But this is better than the kinesis of meaning that we had before. So another example of reducing the strength of your kinesis. Ah, this is an interesting one. So we've got med given and med not given. And there's not kinesis between these two pieces of item. Now if I change one, the other doesn't have to change. Unless I change them to the same value. This is called contrakinesis, because they don't change together, they change separately, and they cannot collide. And contrakinesis turns out to be a very important thing. Aaron was talking about his XML library earlier today, and he talked about everything's a node. So you have lots of node objects in your XML, in my XML library. In your Grafton library, you also have node objects. We have a collision of names between my classes and your classes. This is contrakinesis between the two things. This is a problem in Ruby. The simple solution to this is nested inside a module. Now, you still have contrakinesis between the module names, but there are fewer top-level modules than there are top-level classes. So the probability of collision is much reduced. So this is good library design, right? Put your stuff in namespaces. And if you're not doing this, shame on you. I have someone complaining on the just this past week about Weirich, because Weirich put some things up in the top level. And the next major version of Weirich is going to address some of those issues. Class node, used all over the place in Ruby, that each one is in its own namespace, so they don't collide. However, suppose you wanted to do something a little funky. For some reason, you wanted to be able to take any Ruby object and convert it to a node. So you put a toNode method in the kernel. It's funky, I know. Let's just pretend for the moment. And the guy doing the graphing library wants to do the same thing. Now we have a kinesis collision between the node names, method names, inside a single class. There's no good solution for this other than to don't name your methods and kernel in the public classes that you monkey patch. Or don't monkey patch if you don't have to, and if you really got to, give them unique names that won't collide. Eventually, Ruby might get selector namespaces that will address this issue, but we don't have them yet. That's coming in Ruby 2, maybe. They have to figure out how to do it officially. Okay, another kind of kinesis. Suppose I have a checksum library. And I have I take string of digits and I add a check digit to it. So I have this string and I add an 8 to it. And that provides a certain checksum. I also have a check method that will return true or false depending upon whether the check digit is correct or not. And the code for these things look like this. Really simple code, but there's really an interesting fact. These two methods do some different things, but they are coupled by the algorithm used to calculate the checksum. If I decide to switch from a simple sum up the digits and mod it by 10 algorithm to something more elaborate, like XOR, I have to change both places. So changing in one is changed by the other. There's no name kinesis between here. There's no position kinesis. There's no meaning, there's no data that we're depending upon particular meanings for. We call this kinesis of algorithm, because the algorithms have to agree in two different places of code. Now, one solution for this tends to be take that common code, move it out, and put it in its own library. And now you've reduced this again to kinesis of name, because you're depending upon the name of the method that identifies the algorithm. You can't always do this. Sometimes you have kinesis of algorithm between your Ruby library and that Java library over there that you're talking to over the web. You have to agree on the protocol. That's kinesis of algorithm. Sometimes you can't pull this trick, but it's good to know that it's there. Okay, it's also known as dry. So we see that, hey, this kinesis idea is kind of feeding into these other principles that we already know about. Interesting. This is one here. Suppose you have an account object that you credit the amount of the account, and you create a whole bunch of threads, and all these threads try to add $1 to that account. What's going to happen?
Crazy stuff.
Let's walk through this. This is interesting. Not if you've never done threaded programming before, this might surprise you a wee bit. If you've done threads, you're really familiar with this. Okay, so the number there at the bottom, 23 is the amount in the account right now. This is thread 1 and thread 2 there at the top. We copy the 23 into a local register in the first thread. And at that point in time, we get a time slice change. And the other thread starts to run. It also copies the 23 into its local storage. The first guy gets to run again. He increments and stores it back. The second guy increments and stores back. And the final result should be 25 because we've incremented twice, but instead it's 24. We've lost data because we have a race condition between the two threads. A race condition is kinesis of timing, where the timing of elements in your program will affect its outcome. Now the solution to this is, for this particular problem, is fairly straightforward. You want to reorder the steps so that steps 1 and 2 happen together, and steps 3 and 4 happen together, and you can't split them up. If you do this, by adding mutexes and synchronizing, you'll solve that problem. And there's other threading issues that I'd love to talk to you about, but really don't relate to kinesis. So I'm going to move on. Okay, so I find kinesis very interesting. Because when I look at that, I begin to see all these elements of all these other principles coming into play. We saw the dry principle kind of arise out of the issue of kinesis of algorithm. We saw, how many people are familiar with the law of Demeter? Okay, essentially the law of Demeter says you shouldn't create a train wreck in your code. In other words, method dot method dot method dot method, it's a long train, it's going to crash. And the reason for that is because every method call is another addition of kinesis to that method. So you're building up a long chain of kinesis. So that ties into the law of Demeter. The solid principles, single responsibility principles. If you get into the solid principles, there's a lot of kinesis-based issues in that. So I think kinesis is kind of like the quarks in physics. They're the building blocks that you can start talking about bigger things. Now, kinesis is very low level. You're not going to build principles out of this kinesis or that kinesis, but you can begin to look at them and base your principles upon understanding of kinesis. And by understanding these principles of how software relates to other pieces, of why when you change your piece of code, I have to rewrite my library, understanding that is going to help us to build better codes, make better design decisions. There's other kinds of kinesis here I didn't have time to talk about. We talked about most of the static ones. Kinesis of type just means you have a variable, two variables that have to both be integers. Okay, that's simple. The dynamic kinesis is really interesting. It's good to look into more of that. We've got a couple rules about kinesis. I think these are the beginnings of a unified software development theory. Now, I don't think it's going to cover everything. I think there's other issues involved in new software development, such as readability. Kinesis doesn't really directly address. But in terms of maintenance and changing code base, I think it's a very good start. So, how am I doing on time? Okay, let's go ahead and take books. talk is up on GitHub under my name. It's called presentation_kinesis. And there's a PDF up there. You can grab that and look at that if you want to check out these references. The Milo Page Jones book is there. The Bob Martin book is up there. So that's a good choice. So questions? Yes?
What's the best way to teach this to new programmers or programmers switching to something new?
I'm really disappointed that there's not more talk about Kinesis in the general programming public, right? This book was written in the 90s, 12 years ago, 13 years ago. And why there's not more talk about it, I'm really disappointed in that. How to teach it to new people coming in, I think you need to have an understanding of yourself and take on a mentorship, an apprenticeship with other programmers. Bring them in and train them, you know, under a mentor. Like I said, that first book I got from Glenford Myers was because my mentor, the guy that I was programming under in my very first programming job, came, he laid the book on my desk and said, Jim, read this book. So I think the ideas of software craftsmanship, you got to take those and run with those to teach the people in our industry. I think that's the best way. Yeah?
You might have said this and I missed it. Would you say that the different types of kinesis are really different types of coupling?
The question is, are different kinds of kinesis different kinds of coupling? The answer is yes. Essentially, kinesis is another name for coupling. The problem is with the term coupling is that everybody has a different idea of what it is. And we don't have really firm definitions of it. So Paige Jones took the Kinesis name and said, okay, this is what Kinesis means. So we've got a firmer understanding of the meanings of that. And that's why I kind of like her. Plus Kinesis is really fun to say. A lot of people came to me today and said, what are you talking about? So I'm going to talk about Kinesis today. Sounds deep. Yes.
Are there any code analysis tools that you're aware of that would help
Good question. Ron asked if there are any code analysis tools that would tell us about different kinds of kinesis. Not that I'm aware of. There are some tools that do older style metrics. Some of the solid principles, those are the first five instead of about 10 principles Bob Martin talks about. And some of the later principles are couplings between larger pieces of code, and there are some tools that do those kinds of metrics. But yeah, that's good.
Yeah. I was wondering if you think that possibly you can explain some of the things like readability in terms of like social kinesis, like kinesis of programmers.
The question is, he's wondering if they're, repeat that, I want to say what you said.
Well, if you think of it in terms of social kinesis.
Social, he says, is there some kind of social kinesis, or kinesis of programmers that might explain mutability? I don't know. Kinesis definitely means if I change this, this has to change. I'm not quite sure how to apply that to the mutability issue. So like I said, I'm not there for the grand theory. The whole thing. Yeah.
I was going to say that maybe it's a different word, a different approach is like design patterns are all about trying to create contaminations of naming, right? Everything gets a little reduced down to that naming or that structure. Every problem is reduced to structures, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of like a response to kind of like these things that you are finding in this person's mouth. It's kind of like there's some kind of link there.
Yeah, so you're saying there's some kind of link between design patterns and the way they reduce things down to a particular pattern, the structure, and the idea of kinesis. Yeah.
That's what
they're thinking
of. All of the different ways and how to turn it into structure, and all of that is really just how you need and organize.
Yeah, because the design patterns at the beginning before talking about have a very definite name
right.
And structure to that. Yeah. I actually thought that long. Yeah. Really, these are all good things that I'm really encouraging you guys to start thinking about. And if I can get more people involved in thinking about how software is developed and how we can do it better, then I've achieved my goal. Thank you very much.